Hey guys, Brian Schultz here with Cape Falcon Kayak, and I'm really excited to share with you today two traditional Inuit hunting kayak replicas that I just finished building here in the shop. So the kayaks you see beside me here are Northern Inupiaq kayaks, which is the traditional hunting kayaks of the cultural group that spans from roughly around the area of Norton Sound all the way up to the very far north in Alaska. So much higher up than, say, the Aleutian Islands. And these particular kayaks are from kind of a central region called Kotzebue Sound, and these would have been used up into the rivers that feed Kotzebue Sound. They would have been used to hunt both sea mammals but also inland animals as well, like swimming caribou. So having these kayaks in the shop here right now gives me a really great opportunity to talk about the process of constructing traditional Inuit hunting kayaks and how that's a little bit different from the more modern and more simplified kayaks that I usually build here. But it also gives me a chance to explore a unique kayak design that we don't see being built very often, because generally when people are rebuilding historic Inuit kayaks, they're either building Greenland kayaks or they're building Bidarkas. And so much of the diversity and the richness of traditional Inuit hunting kayaks gets kind of left behind, because oftentimes those kayaks aren't quite as user-friendly, or at least aren't as adapted to what modern paddlers usually want to do when they go out kayaking. So what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to go through these frames, and I'm going to talk a little bit about these particular kayaks in general, the process that I went through to rebuild them. I'm going to go through a lot of the details in really close detail, because there's a lot of fascinating stuff in these particular frames. And then finally, I'm going to give you my paddling impressions, because even though these kayaks were sold as architectural installations that are going to be on display, I felt like I couldn't pass up the opportunity to see what they felt like on the water. So I saran wrapped them up really tight, put them on the water for a little bit, and got a feel for what a traditional hunter in this type of boat might have felt like on the water. So it'd be really interesting to share that as well. So what is an Inupiaq kayak? I would say that the general features that kind of define this sort of kayak shape is that it has a very symmetrical deck shape and a very symmetrical hull shape, meaning that it's shaped pretty much the same in the front as it is in the back. Sometimes it's a little bit fuller in the front section. It has a cockpit that's sitting almost right in the middle of the kayak, sometimes a little bit further back than that. And that cockpit sits on top of a flat deck in the back and a very high peaked deck in the front of the combing here. Now, the ends of this kayak are unique in that the stringers and the keel and also the gunnels just all come together to terminate at the end of the kayak. So there's not a separate stem piece that would act as a cutwater, and that results in a kayak that is much more maneuverable, which might be advantageous in certain hunting scenarios. I'll talk a little bit more about that when I talk about my paddling impressions for this particular boat. Now, the overall measurement variability in these was between 12 feet and 18 feet long, between about 6.5 and 8.5 inches deep, at least at the back of the cockpit, and also between 17 and 22 inches wide. Now, the shaping variation between different cultural groups within the Inupiaq was a much boxier shaped hull in the southern and more inland areas, and also a much flatter rocker. And in the northern areas, like up by Point Barrow, you would have seen kayaks that had more of a rounded hull shape and also much more rocker in them, which would have been a little bit slower boat, but possibly more seaworthy. And so it's possible that the variations in shaping had to do with different ocean conditions and also different hunting techniques. But it's also possible that it was just variability by how the knowledge was passed down in that particular area. These two kayaks are sourced from Harvey Golden's book, Kayaks of Alaska. They are plate number 70 and plate number 71, and then I based the framing details of the interior of these off of Harvey's research photos and also off of the frame drawings for different kayaks, which is plate number 72 and plate number 73 in Harvey's books. The larger of these two kayaks is 16 feet long by 20 inches wide by 8 inches deep. It's a fairly slab-sided kayak with a really flat bottom. It has very little rocker along the length of the hull. The deck on this thing is really high peaked. This is actually at the top of the range for the collected examples. I think the distance from the top of this deck to the bottom of the kayak here is somewhere around 15 inches, so very deep. The smaller of these two kayaks is 14 feet long by 19 inches wide by 7 inches deep, and it has more of a flared hull section, although it still has that flat bottom that is kind of characteristic of kayaks from this particular region. The way that I like to start rebuilding any kind of traditional replica kayak is to try to get the deck shape and the sheer exactly right, because if you get both of those things right, then you can use your shear line to measure down to get your heights for your rocker. And I find that to be a lot more convenient than setting up over a dead flat surface and having to be stuck there while you're taking your measurements up off the floor. So that's just my own particular process. So recreating the shear, especially on the larger one of these kayaks, was actually quite challenging. Anytime that you're looking to figure out how to recreate the shear of a traditional kayak, you have to take the visible flare angle of the gunwales, the width of the kayak, and the length of the kayak, and do a little bit of math to figure out what shear line that would naturally project. And then you can measure the difference between that shear line and the shear line that's visible in the drawing, and it can give you some idea of how you need to shape your gunwales. And in the case of these North Alaskan kayaks here, they were usually shaped by carving the top of the gunwale away, so it would result in a gunwale that, once it's all put together, is very flat on the shear line and then just turns up a little bit at the ends. And of course, there is variation there. This kayak is actually a little bit of an exception in that it does have a very natural continuous shear line, but this one took a lot of figuring out. I actually mocked it up 3 times half size and 2 times full scale so I could get that shear line just perfect. Now, something else that I'm doing whenever I'm rebuilding a traditional kayak is I'm trying to get a sense of the logic of the original builder, because you have to imagine that these kayaks were passed down generation to generation through kind of general rules and building systems. And there's a lot that's been written about this as far as kayakers using what's called anthropometric measurements, which is measurements that relate to certain distances on your body that then can then be communicated to future generations of builders, so they know, for instance, that these deck beams need to be this far apart or something like that. And you know, it's a little bit risky to make too many assumptions about that. I think what a lot of modern builders will do is they'll read a very kind of narrow historical account that talks about using some type of anthropometric measurements and then try to apply it to a much broader context than it was originally used in. And you see a lot of that in people that are rebuilding traditional Greenland kayaks. But as far as just kind of an exercise in understanding, it's always really interesting when I'm building a framework to see if I can figure out what their original building systems were. And sometimes I'll get done with a frame and I'm just like, I have no idea. And in that case, if I wanted to reproduce it again, I would just reproduce it with my original measurements for all of the pieces. But in something like this, sometimes I can figure out what the systems were, which is really cool, because if you can figure out the system the original builder was using, then you can reproduce the kayak in a way that doesn't mean that you have to rely on measurements. And it also means that you can scale it up or down, which is kind of cool, especially if you're like me and you like to create plans for people to be able to follow so they can reproduce kayaks, but size them appropriately to their personal body. So what I realized over the course of building this is that this is probably one of the most anthropometric boats that I've seen so far. And part of that is because it's a very simple shaping system. You know, there's a lot of complexity in the intricacy in the framework in this, actually a surprising amount, but the overall shape of this kayak kind of from a distance is very simple. It's very symmetrically shaped, very evenly shaped along the bottom. And both of those things tend to lend themselves more easily to using really simple body measurement systems to get the shaping that you're looking for. I can tell just through the process of building this that the spacing on the deck beams was this far for all the deck beams and all the ribs. In the middle of the kayak, it actually got a little bit closer together. It was about a fist width. And there were measurements just all over the place in here where I was able to kind of drop a hand or an arm. I'm kind of a medium-sized person. I'm 5'8", you know, so I probably have body measurements that probably aren't exactly Inupiat-sized, but are closer than, say, someone of a larger stature would be. And so it was really interesting to figure that out. Now, another thing that I learned while I was building these is that I believe that this hull shape is created just by applying the simplest possible rib measuring system, which is just laying a length of rib stock across the kayak at that location, and then adding a body measurement to the end of that and cutting it off. And in the case of this particular kayak, it turns out that this distance plus this amount creates this particular rib shape. And in this kayak, it's that distance plus this amount that creates that particular hull shape. And I had to re-rib both of these kayaks 3 different times to figure it out and to make sure that I was right about how that was gonna work out. But it's really cool that that actually did end up reproducing the exact hull shape of the original, because that lets me know that that's probably what the original builder was using. And if you followed the rest of my work, from my canoe building courses to my kayak building courses, you know that I am obsessed with rib shaping systems and rib shaping formulas, because once you can find a formula that works for a particular type of kayak, that frees you up to be able to scale that up and down like I was just talking about earlier, and not having to have exact measurements for everything. It doesn't work for all Arctic kayaks, but some of them, like this one, it works quite well for. So these particular frameworks are, as you can see, pretty darn intricate. You know, you've got a very close spacing of stringers and ribs, lots of really interesting little shaping nuances. So what I want to do here is just start at the bow on both of these kayaks and just walk you through all the little details so you can see some of the idiosyncrasies of this particular type of kayak construction. So starting at the bow here, you can see how the gunwales and the keel all come together at the end. It's a very simple arrangement. It doesn't have a lot of the more complicated joinery that you sometimes see in Alaskan kayaks. It's held together with just some really simple lashings. The lashings are different with each of these kayaks, but they accomplish the same function. The other kayak originally would have had nails driven across here and bent over, and this kayak might have as well. I just couldn't see up into the end of it, and so I decided to reproduce the detail on a frame that I could see. Now, something that looks simple that is actually a lot more complicated is the fact that this keel here isn't just a square, small piece of wood. The keel actually flares out into a very wide piece of wood here that then gets shaped down and dished out on the inside. Now, moving back along the deck here, we come to the first deck beam. Most of the deck beams in this are fairly small. They're only about 7/8 inches wide by 5/8 inches tall, and they are through mortised all the way through to the outside and pegged from the top with pegs. And this is something that's interesting to point out, because oftentimes when people think about traditional things, they imagine that they were made fairly roughly, but the details on the frames that we can see shows that the mortising was actually fairly fine here, and the tenoning was really carefully done. And so even though I did this with modern tools, the original might have looked this accurate as the ones that I'm creating here. Now, coming back a little bit further, we get into the first deck beam that is also tied into the frame. And this is an arrangement that you see on a lot of different Inuit kayaks. There is a diagonal lashing that extends from the deck beam down at an angle and ties around the gunwale. And one of the things that we did when we were doing this is, to match the original, we very carefully carved out the outside of the gunwale so these lashings wouldn't create a bump underneath the skin, which would have created a wear point if this kayak were intended to be used on the water. The gunwales here, moving backwards, you can see are tied together with a couple of lashings that extend across the bottom of the gunwales all the way around and then get wrapped to create tension in that lashing. And there's 2 of these in the front of this kayak. You can also see that this deck ridge here is tied on with just a really simple square lashing. And I'm not 100% sure that this is the lashing that would have been used in this kayak. There were actually a few different types that were used in this, but this is basically just a simple square lashing. It's a running lashing, so this is a continuous piece of line, which is something that would have been a feature of this kayak, at least according to Harvey's book. Now, moving back here, coming further and further and further, you can see that every other one of these deck beams is lashed, and the lashings are set on opposite sides of the deck beam so the deck beam doesn't twist forward or twist back. The deck beams themselves are spaced almost exactly 6 inches apart, which is almost exactly the width of my hand, which is how I think both the deck beams and the ribs were spaced in this. And if you look down into the framework here, you could see that the ribs are set right in between each of the deck beams. And I think that was a deliberate choice just to keep the gunnels strong by not having too much joinery in one specific area of gunnels. Now, heading back into the cockpit area here, as we get closer and closer and this deck starts to peak up like this, this is where things got really challenging for me. And most of the time, these deck beams would have been made out of natural crooks of wood. The nice thing about being a coastal dwelling people is that oftentimes there's driftwood, and when trees fall in the water, they fall in the water with their roots exposed, which gives kayak builders an awesome palette of natural crooks that they can work from. They can just go around and cut things off to match whatever height they need for their next deck beam. And oftentimes people would be collecting this wood over the course of a year or two as kind of a selection of materials that they could put into their next kayak. Now, of course, me being a modern builder here and not having access to large root balls or a bunch of driftwood, I actually had to build these up with separate pieces of wood and then carve them to look like natural crooks. And this isn't actually completely unprecedented. Even in the photos that I could see of the inside of these originals, it was obvious that a couple of these were pieced together. And the workmanship between these two kayaks was very different. This kayak here, the original, at least from what I could see from the interior photographs, was very finely crafted, whereas the other one was a little bit rougher looking on the inside. But I think they both had at least one pieced deck beam and also deck beams with shims sitting on top so they could get the particular line of the swoop of the deck here. Now you can see that these tall deck beams here are actually lashed on individually as opposed to the continuous lashing that I was using further up in the kayak. And another thing that really interests me about these is that the tenon that is coming out of these does not come naturally at the same angle as the deck beam. And this was a huge surprise to me because you would expect, and what I've seen in a lot of other kayaks, is that the tenon angle is naturally projecting down off the end of the deck beam. And that is a much easier way to make a tenon. And then the builder, of course, would just kind of carefully chop out either a full mortise or a blind mortise at that same angle. But for whatever reason, these were all mortised at the same height and at the same angle, and the builder must have had to really take care, especially working with more rudimentary tools, to cut the angle of this tenon. So heading back to the combing here, you could see that this combing is actually pretty substantial in its dimension. This combing is almost 3/4 inch thick by 1 1/4 inch tall. And this whole area gave me a lot of respect for the traditional builders of these kayaks, because even with my very best bending oak and modern woodworking techniques, it was quite challenging to get this to bend into this radius and then to also bend into the three-dimensional curve that allows it to curve down like this and match the drawing. So if you can imagine the traditional builder doing this with cold bent softwoods and without modern adhesives, you could see how this would have been a pretty challenging and a pretty skilled thing to do. The combing itself is lashed on with a couple of really interesting lashings here. In the different drawings and also the different photographs I saw of the originals, these were done in a lot of different ways. So I just basically picked the one that I liked the most and I used this as the lashing detail for the combing. The combing actually doesn't rest on the deck beams in the front or in the back here. It rests on top of the deck ridge and then gets tied in place and stabilized off to the side with stanchions. Now, these little stanchions here were also kind of challenging. It looks pretty simple. You've just got a little piece of wood cut to a bevel, and then it comes up, and then the combing sits in the saddle. But while I was trying to get all this fitted into place, I was actually quite frustrated because this looks like you could just jam any old piece of wood in here and tie it off and it would work. But it actually takes a little bit of finesse to get this to fit right in this location. And this is actually the simplest of this type of stanchion arrangement. Oftentimes, these had multiple bird's mouths that really stabilized them tightly in place. So just one more little detail that was a little more challenging than I thought. Something I want to point out on the other kayak here is just this little ledge that's integrated into this deck beam right here that stops this deck stringer from coming any further forward. And this was common but not universal in these kayaks, which is why I only put it on one of the frames. And it's just an interesting little detail that I think really adds a lot of richness to the framework. All right, so moving back from the combing here, we get into the aft deck framing. The deck beams in this area are spaced a little bit closer together. They're only about this far apart. I imagine that was to make this area a little bit stronger in case the paddler was sitting on top of it when he was getting in and out of the kayak. Other than that, the framing is very similar to the front of the kayak. These deck beams are lashed on opposite sides. Every other deck beam, each of the ribs is pegged, and I used a continuous lashing to attach the deck ridge. And then finally, coming to the back here, I've got another couple of those cross lashings that are holding the gunnels together, and it terminates in the exact same way as the keel and the gunnels do in the front, with just a couple of simple lashings. All right, so that's the framing for the deck for these kayaks. Now let's go ahead and turn it over and we'll talk about the hull and the stringers and the ribs. So starting at the bow again, you can really see that shaping detail I was talking about earlier, where the keel just slowly transitions into this much wider, thicker section here that gets dished out on the inside. And it's really obvious that this would add a lot of strength to this area, although it would do so at the expense of significantly more effort in building this part of the kayak. So you know it's a detail that was important to them. Now, the keel is lashed on in a really interesting way. There's just holes that are drilled at each rib, and then you've got a lashing that runs around each rib into the next one, into the next one, into the next one. And it's not the most secure arrangement, but it certainly works. The stringers are lashed on with a really interesting lashing pattern. It just comes off the top of one rib, across the stringer, and then around the rib, and then across the stringer, and then around the rib, and across the stringer. And it just makes kind of a Z shape as it moves down the kayak. And just like the keel, this is not a very secure attachment. We had to pull very hard on the artificial sinew to keep these in place. So even though this was the traditional lashing pattern, if I was rebuilding this kayak for my own use on the water, I would probably use a more secure lashing than this particular running lashing. Now, the ribs here are really a little bit more challenging to make than you would expect. Most of the kayaks that I build these days have ribs that are a uniform thickness all the way around, and that's nice because then you just run them through a table saw. They're really easy to produce, and they also bend really easily. But something that is a feature of this kayak that we'll talk about here in a second is that these kayaks had a very flat bottom, at least the ones in this location. And to get that flat bottom, you actually have to shape the ribs in a really specific way. So you can see here, I've got one of my reject ribs, and it's very thin down here. It's only about a quarter inch, but across the entire bottom here, it's 3/8 of an inch thick. And so I had to actually thin each one of these individually so it would have this thick section in the middle. And that's how we end up getting this very flat bottom on both of these kayaks. And it should be noted that not all Inupiaq kayaks have flat bottoms like this. This is specific to the kayaks from this region. And it's just another one of those places where you can tell that a lot of effort went into getting this particular shape. And I'm not sure exactly what that accomplished, but anytime that you see where somebody did a lot more work to create a result, you can imagine it was a detail that was important to them for some reason. So I think that's a good segue into the last thing I want to talk about here, which is just how these kayaks paddled on the water. Because even though these boats were intended for architectural display, I did wrap them with Saran wrap so I could get in them and see how they felt on the water for a few minutes. And the first thing I can say is that these kayaks do not paddle like modern recreational kayaks, which isn't surprising, but it's something that a lot of people don't understand when they're thinking about potentially building an exact copy of a historic Inuit kayak. But you have to understand that the needs that we have as modern recreational kayakers are not the same needs that you had as a traditional Inuit kayak hunter. And if you had a kayak that was maybe extremely frustrating to paddle just in a general paddling context, but was extremely good for whatever reason at being able to kill a particular type of sea mammal, well, in that case, those would be the features that would be selected for and then passed on to future generations. So I never really expect an Inuit kayak to paddle in a way that I would immediately find comfortable, but I always find it really interesting to explore it on its own terms, which is the best way to paddle any Arctic kayak. So As far as how these paddle, both of these are very different. The larger of these two is extremely unstable, which is very interesting because it's actually fairly wide and it has a very boxy hull section, but it carries so much of its volume to the ends of the kayak that it raises it up in the water to where you're only sitting on a still a fairly narrow water line. And I would say that this kayak actually has what I would call negative stability, meaning that for whatever reason, that perfectly flat bottom actually wants to push you off to one side or another, which is very unsettling. And it only has a tiny bit of stability right on that edge at about 7 degrees of heel, and then just no stability at all. And then right at the edge, about 25 degrees or so, it had a little bit of stability, but it was just very strange. It was the most unusual stability profile I've ever seen, with those really specific hard spots and almost no instability in between. So a really big surprise there. As far as the cockpit, I was also surprised that that very high cockpit that comes up into your armpits actually wasn't uncomfortable on the water. It was just outside of my paddling stroke. I didn't hit it with my elbows or my hands while I was paddling. These kayaks would have originally been paddled with a single-bladed or a double-bladed paddle, although I only tried this with a double-bladed paddle. Now, my comfort in the cockpit was also a big surprise. You know, the nice thing about having this really high deck here is that you can raise your knees up, which is much more comfortable than sitting with your legs straight flat. And you would think that that would come at the trade-off of not being very securely attached to the inside of the boat. But I found that just the way that these last two deck beams in the front here are oriented just gave me a perfect little spot to be able to lock my knees in. And I felt very confident that I would have been able to stay attached to the kayak if I'd rolled. And this is a cultural group that didn't know how to roll. And I believe they rolled with both single and double bladed paddles. So very interesting there as well. Now, as far as how this thing actually paddled on the water, this, not surprisingly, has very little directional stability. You know, it's one of these kayaks that, almost like a whitewater kayak, if you're not actively paddling it, it will immediately veer off to one side or another. And that's something that you might think would be a design flaw, but these kayaks were oftentimes used to hunt caribou, and one of the features of that type of a hunt is that the caribou are very fast, which means you need a very swift kayak to be able to catch them, which this one is, but also they can tend to dart away right at the same moment as you want to try to harpoon them. So if you can imagine the original context of how this was used, you'd be chasing down the caribou, and then at the last moment, you would grab your harpoon and you'd need to harpoon it, and having a kayak that would immediately veer off to that direction could be the difference between making contact with the animal or not. So definitely different than other Arctic kayaks that I've been in, but there's not really a better or worse, there's just a difference. Now, the final thing that's really notable about this kayak is the speed. This is one of the faster kayaks that I've ever paddled. And I put a GPS on this while I was paddling it. I paddled as hard as I could. I was able to get it up above 7 miles per hour, which is pretty good. So very unstable, very fast, very maneuverable. Now, this other kayak here, the smaller one, was actually the kayak I felt the most comfortable in, and its hull shape is a little bit more flared, it has a little bit more rocker, and so it's sitting down on its lines a lot more comfortably than this kayak right here, which means that it could engage a little bit more of the full width to get some stability out of. And so it wasn't a super stable kayak, but it was predictable, which was very different than this one right here. And I felt pretty comfortable in it for that reason. It was also just more of a size that seemed to fit my body, to where I felt really nice and connected to the kayak. And this particular shape, modified a little bit and made a little bit longer, would be probably more like how one of the Point Barrow or Northern Inupiaq kayaks would feel. And that's kind of the kayak that I would be more interested in. So obviously this kayak wasn't as fast because of the rocker and also because it was a little bit shorter. So, you know, a little bit different, but once again, not good or bad, just different. So I guess the final question is, would I build these again? And would I build them for my own personal paddling use? And the answer is maybe. This particular kayak here, the Kotzebue Sound kayak with the very little rocker and the very flat bottom and the relative deeper depth, is something that I'm not particularly interested in just because it is such a strange feeling kayak on the water. It might have been the perfect kayak for swimming, chasing down swimming caribou, but definitely not the perfect kayak for the kind of paddling that I want to do. Now, on the other hand, this other one, which was from the same cultural area, but is more similar to the northern Inupiaq kayaks, is something that I'm very interested in because one of the paddling uses that I have that I've never really found the perfect boat for is something that I can use on big water rivers that have a lot of flat water sections, but also some white water sections that I need to get through. So really what you need is a sea kayak and a whitewater boat. And when you look at this kind of general hull shape here, you could see how you could potentially accomplish both, because with these ends that swoop up like this without the stems, you're gonna have a kayak that's gonna be loose enough that you'll be able to maneuver it in moderate rapids, but the overall hull shape and the longer length of it is going to allow you to really make miles over the flats. And so I'm considering rebuilding something like this kayak right here. So that's kind of a design project. Time will tell if I have the time to get to it. I imagine I'll build at least one just to satisfy my own curiosity. I'll be happy to put up a video for that when I do. And of course, if it turns out well, I'll have to build 10 more and then make a course for how to build them. So anyways, that's this video. I want to say a big thank you to Harvey Golden for generous access to his research materials, all the work that he's done over all these years rebuilding traditional historic Inuit kayaks, and also the two books that he's written that I rely on constantly and heavily here in my own work, Cape Falcon Kayaks. So thank you, Harvey. Also, thank you to the Native Corporation that sponsored this particular build. I wouldn't have had the time or the money to take on such a complicated or intricate project without your generous support. So I really appreciate you commissioning these kayaks. All right, that's it for now. If you like this video, make sure you hit that like and subscribe button. You can also check me out on my website, which is capefalconkayaks.com, where I've got a ton more videos about skin-on-frame kayaks, skin-on-frame kayak building courses. You can also find me on Instagram, that is at Cape Falcon Builds, where I post a daily build blog whenever I'm building here in the shop and share all kinds of details that you're not going to see anywhere else but inside of my paid courses, and even sometimes details that you're not going to see anywhere else, period. So thanks for watching. Take care. I hope you enjoyed this video. I'll see you next time.